Welcome back. I'm Pam Curnow. I'm the teaching director for the Castle Rock CBS class, and I'm glad that you decided to come back and join us again this week. We are continuing our study in the Gospel of John, and we are still in chapter one. But the Apostle John, he opens the study with powerful words that describe the word Jesus Christ. And so I'm going to start our morning by reading those words, and then I'm going to open in prayer. Starting in chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God, and all things were made through him, and without him not anything was made that was made. In him was life, and that life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it." John 1, 1 through 5. So let me open a prayer. Father, we just ask you to join us now. We ask you to be glorified. I have been just overwhelmed this week thinking about these are your words. These are the words that you have written in the Holy Scriptures. These are the words for today. They are the words for eternity. They are the words of life. And so, Father, you are the one who can bring those words to life. You are the one who can set those words on fire. So I pray that you will do that very thing this morning, that you would capture hearts, that you would capture lives and transform us from the inside out, Father, by your powerful word. I pray this in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So let's get started. So in John 1, 1 through 5, we learn that Jesus Christ is the Word, that he is eternal, that he has no beginning, he has no end, that he is God, he was with God, that all things are created through him and in him. So then we move into John verses 9 through 18, and John now begins to turn our eyes to kind of define, kind of enhance and enhance our understanding of who the Word is, who he is, and what he has done. So in these verses in 9 through 18, he actually describes Jesus Christ as the coming in flesh, the Word who has come in flesh, who has come among mankind. He is the true light, he says, and that all who receive and believe in him, in his name, Jesus Christ, they will be saved. So that's where we're moving into. Now, there are two divisions I think I found within this verse, the verses 9 through 18. The first one is the response to the true light, and we see this in verses 9 through 13, and then in 14 through 18, we see the glory of the true light. So I want you to be able to follow me and know where we're going in the scriptures. Make sure your Bibles are open to the Gospel of John chapter 1. But before we jump into it, let me begin with this story. And it's a story about the life and the mission of Diane Fossey. Now, she was a California zoologist, and she left the comforts of home to move to Africa and live among the rare mountain gorillas in Rwanda. She dedicated her life to protecting them from extinction because there was the poachers out there, the cruelty of the poachers that were slaughtering them for profit. And so on the side of a 14,000-foot rain-shrouded volcano, Diane began her mission. After several years, the gorillas came to accept her as one of their own, and she named them, and she cradled their babies, and she cried with them when they mourned their dead. And she wrote this. She said that these powerful but shy and gentle animals accepted and responded to my attentions when I acted like a gorilla. So I learned to scratch and groom and beat my chest. I imitated their hoots and grunts and belches. I munched on the foliage that they ate, and I kept low to the ground and deliberate in movements. Now, after 18 years with the gorillas, she became like them, dwelling among them, and they were her friends. When they faced danger, she bravely defended them. She stood with them. She lived with them. She wept with them. And then in the early hours of December 27th of 1985, she was murdered. Apparently, it was by poachers. They've never found who did it. But it was the trade that the poachers that she had sought to destroy. And so she died for those that she came to live among and to save. Now stop for a minute and think about that. 2,000 years ago, Jesus Christ, the Word and the Light, left the comforts of his home for the fog-shrouded volcano of Earth. He came, he was born of the flesh, he lived among us, he identified with us, he learned our names, he wept with us, and he too died for those that he came to live among and to save. Yet his death was much different. It was not in vain. His life, his death, and his resurrection, it bridged the gap between God and his creation, which is you and I. As we study verses 9 through 18, we'll see that the Word, Jesus Christ, is the true light. And he has become flesh and he has dwelt among us. He is the giver of life and light. So let's read those scriptures. So the true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world and the world was made through him. Yet the world did not know him. He came to his own and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we've seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. Now John bore witness about me because he was before me. For from his fullness we have all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ, and no one has ever seen the only God who is at the Father's side has made him known. So John 1, 9 through 18, and I think I skipped a little bit about John the Baptist in the middle of that. But going into our first division, responding to the true light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. John 9, verse 9 says, and that is, I want you to grasp it. It's a powerfully profound statement that the true light, Jesus Christ, God incarnate, God in the flesh, has given light to everyone, and he's come into the world. Such a transforming moment. So God, the creator of all things, comes down to his creation. He enlightens all of mankind, and one would expect us or mankind to welcome him. But we will see in the scripture that there are very different responses as we continue. So now he gives light to everyone, or some translations will say enlightens every man. Now some find that the true light, which gives light to everyone, is a troublesome statement. Some narrow that interpretation, that verse, to mean that every man is only those who receive him. But if we are serious students of the scripture, then one of our very first principles is that we allow scripture to interpret scripture, and we look at the whole scripture in context. So by applying this principle and looking at the context of John 9 through 13, it seems to refer to those in the world who don't receive him as well as those who do. So the world, the word world is called cosmos, and it describes a physical world. It also describes humanity in general, and then it's also frequently, most often used in scripture as to describe the evil system that is dominated by Satan. So then what does it mean that the true light has been given to everyone? Throughout time, God has revealed himself in creation and in conscience, which indicates that man's response to the true light is without excuse. The Apostle Paul, he further expounds upon this very critical truth in Romans 1, 18 through 20. And if you're not familiar with this one, go back and read Romans 1 and 2. It will kind of give you a broader sense of what is spoken of here. But Romans 1, verse 19 says, "For what can be known of God is plain to them, because God has shown it to them. For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and his divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world in the things that he has made." So if you take that, you would say that man is without excuse. So now Jesus Christ, God incarnate in the flesh, comes to the world, and he's the fullest revelation of God. He is God's self-disclosure in the most glorious way, and he comes to all of mankind. He comes to illuminate the minds of humanity. And the choice to believe or not believe is now no longer, it's not a crisis of intellect. It is rather a crisis of the will. When a darkened mind is exposed to the light, but chooses to remain in the darkness, then no one is to blame but the individual who makes that choice. No one can legitimately claim ignorance. So let me use another illustration, one that I heard this week that might help you to understand it even more clearly. So in every modern house today, we're connected to an electrical grid, and that provides all the energy that is necessary to illuminate every dark corner of our house. Now, there are people living in these type of homes that can choose. We can choose to live in the light, or we can choose to live in the dark. Light is available to us, but it isn't obligatory. And so the tragic reality is that many will reject the light of the world, Jesus Christ, and remain willfully blind. That is tragic. Now, I want you to know that I struggle with this. I struggle with the thought that people would choose the darkness over the light. I don't struggle with the truth of the scripture, but I struggle with, because there are those that I love who do not know Jesus Christ. They do not know him as Lord and Savior. And God's heart is so clear in scripture. It is a heart of love, and it's a heart of mercy and grace. And 2 Peter 3:9 assures us of that. It says that the Lord is slow to fulfill his promise. Now, that passage is talking about justice. So he's not slow in bringing about his promise of justice, as some would count slowness. But it goes on to say, but is patient towards you, not wishing that any should perish, but that all should reach repentance. Now, the source of light has come to everyone, to all, to the world. He's done that because of his great love for us. Because of his great love for his creation, the very creation that when he created, he called was good. So he desires that all will come to repentance, to know God and to be known by God. There is no one that is beyond the saving arm of God. There's no one beyond the saving arm of Christ. There is just no one. And I believe that. But ultimately, all have to make the choice. But I believe in salvation for them, just as God saved me. And so what do? I take up my responsibility. My responsibility to do whatever I can to show them the way. I commit to praying and interceding before the very throne of grace on their behalf. I pray for opportunities to speak and to display life to them. I pray on. And we should too. We pray on and on for those who don't know the Lord. Verse 10, we move into verse 10 and 11, and it tells us that he, Jesus Christ, was in the world. The world was made through him. He came to the world that he made the trees and the grass that he walked on and the hills that he sat upon. And he came to his own, and yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, it says, and his own people did not receive him. So as shocking and tragic as the world's rejection of Christ is, John now turns to an even greater tragedy, and that's Israel's rejection. In the Greek, this reads that he came to his own. That is, he came to that which belonged to him. The expression describes a homecoming. Jesus Christ, the Messiah, came to God's land. He came to the city of David, the land of the temple, God's chosen nation, Israel. Those who had walked all through the centuries just waiting for the Messiah and Savior to come. And yet when he did, he was not welcomed. And like their fathers before them, they hardened their hearts, they stiffened their necks, and they rejected him despite clear testimony from the Old Testament, from the prophets, from John the Baptist. And instead of repenting of their sin and accepting him as Messiah, they cried out, crucify him, crucify him, and his blood shall be on us and our children. A tragedy, a tragedy. But he goes on, John goes on in verses 12 through 13, and it's a but God type statement, because he says, but to all who receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor of the will of man, but of God. So John now turns our attention to those who did welcome Christ in sincere faith. That conjunction, but it's just a small pivot, and it makes a dramatic shift. But God, the world's hatred of God and rejection of Christ, it in no way thwarts God's plans. To all who receive Jesus Christ and believe in his name, he gives them the right to become children of God. So now received could be translated to take hold or obtain or to grasp. We receive Jesus Christ. We believe in the fullness of who he is. So we take a hold of, we obtain, we grasp it. So to receive Christ, it involves more than just our intellectual knowledge of his claims, but it is an action of genuine repentance. Genuine repentance. So to welcome Jesus Christ and to acknowledge him as our Savior and Lord, it is believing in all that Jesus Christ is and all that he has done. It's not possible to separate his deity from his humanity, his being Savior from his being Lord, or his person from his redemptive work. Saving faith accepts Jesus Christ in all that Scripture reveals concerning him. Therefore, it's impossible for us to separate his deity from his humanity. He is Savior, and he is Lord, and through him, redemption from sin is realized. So now he goes on to say he gave the right to become children of God who were born, not of blood, nor of the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. This is verses 12 and 13. So God now grants the privilege of a new birth. No one can attain this new birth by their own power, merit, or ability. Only God can grant it. And it's through that new birth that we become children of God. No longer enemies of God, but instead children of God. Do you hear that? No longer enemies, but children of God. And so John contrasts the spiritual birth with the natural birth. The natural birth, it's the result of two humans who choose to procreate. But by contrast, spiritual birth is the result of God's sovereign choice. The new birth cannot be attained by an act of human will. It has absolutely nothing to do with human planning. It is entirely a gift of God. You know this well-known passage in Ephesians 2, 8, and 9. It says that all are saved entirely by grace through faith, and that not of themselves. It is a gift of God, not as a result of works, so that no one may boast. Now, the Jews rejected their own, but I want you to know that all of mankind bears the guilt of unbelief and rejection. The phrase, but of God, means that salvation, that is receiving and believing in the Lord Jesus Christ, it's impossible for any sinner. God must grant the power supernaturally and with it the divine life and light to the lifeless, darkened sinner. So I want us to think and to take away with this that one cannot come into God's family because you're a Jew by natural birth. Nor can anyone be a child of God because their parents are Christians or grandparents, or they live in the United States, or they attend a Christian school, or they attend church or mass. You do not become a child of God through earthly inheritance or works. God welcomes all into the family of God who receive, get it, his son, Jesus Christ. In Jesus Christ alone, their lives are spiritually reborn. Through faith in Christ, the Holy Spirit begins to change us. He changes us from the inside out. He rearranges our attitudes, our desires, and our motives. Being born makes us physically alive, and it places us in our parents' family. But being born of God makes us spiritually alive and joins us in God's family. The question then becomes, have you received Christ in order for him to make you a new person? God makes this fresh start in life, and it's available to all of us who are in Christ Jesus, all of us. You know what? The chief reason, let me say that clearly, the chief reason that people do not know God is not because he hides from them, but because they hide from him. I want you to hear that again. the chief reason that people do not know God is not because he hides from them, but because they hide from him. Oh, that they may hear and that they may believe and receive Jesus Christ, who is the true light. Now we move into our second division, verses 14 through 18. And the word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we've seen his glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. And skipping over to, for from his fullness, we've all received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, the only God who is at the Father's side. He has made him known. Returning to that powerful term that John uses, the word at the beginning of this gospel, he now continues to reveal who the word is and what it has done. The word, Jesus Christ, becomes flesh, became flesh, and he dwelt among us. Amazing and glorious truth. Emmanuel, God with us. The word, though completely human, fully reveals the Father. He's fully human and he's fully God. Now, in our day, people have trouble accepting Christ's deity, that he is God. But in John's day, they were most troubled by his humanity. John used the description of the word because he used the description of the word flesh intentionally, becomes flesh intentionally. But many of the modern translations have rendered it to become a man, which is true. It is true that Jesus Christ did become a man. But John used that word flesh for a purpose. It was to counteract false teaching. And false teaching that we even see today is called docetism. It's also closely related to Gnosticism. But what it does is it views physical matter as evil. So the body is evil. But intellect and spiritual is good. So it denies that Jesus Christ is both fully human and fully divine. Now, the problem with this false belief is that it denies the very core truths of the gospel, and namely the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. If Jesus did not have a real body, then he did not really die. And if Jesus had no physical body, he could not have been risen from the dead. Without that actual death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, we have no salvation. We are still lost in our sins and our faith is futile. But God, Christ is the perfect expression of God in human form, and to know Christ is to know God. For John says that the Word became flesh, that broke all the rules, which is exactly what God did, and he dwelt among us. Jesus Christ was God's final word to mankind, who became flesh and dwelt among us. The eternal Son not only became man, he also dwelt among men for 33 years. Dwelt literally means to live in a tent. Jesus was God's new tabernacle. In Christ, God came to meet with people. Through Christ, we can come to meet with God. Now, let me repeat that. So in Christ, God comes to meet with people, with mankind, humanity, his creation. And now through Christ, you and I can come to meet with God. Amazing truth. Amazing and glorious. We have been spiritually reborn, and now we become the dwelling place of God, the tabernacle of God. Amazing, glorious. The very one who created you now lives within you. How precious and powerful is that truth? So we see now his glory. We beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. Now this glory is often called the Shekinah glory, because Shekinah denotes in the tent, glory in the tent. So Moses was unable to look upon God. Remember, he was hidden in the cleft of the rock. God hid him there. And he couldn't, because God's holiness permeated his glory. And after Moses met with God and he came down the mountain, God's glory was manifested on his face, and he had to cover his face with a veil. And when the sacrifice was made in the temple, in the Holy of Holies, there was a veil that separated the Holy of Holies. When Jesus Christ died on the cross, that veil was torn from heaven to earth, and that separation allowed access to the Most High. So in the flesh, Jesus Christ manifests that same essential glory as the Father, but it's veiled in human form so that he could walk among us and bring life and light to mankind. What a wonderful truth! Underneath Jesus' appearance as an ordinary Jewish carpenter, the disciples saw the indwelling glory of God. To an outsider, Jesus was nobody special, and today he still is for many. But to those of us who are in Christ Jesus, he is indeed the unique Son of God and filled with glory. You know what? Too often we accuse the disciples of being slow to understand Jesus, but really much of the time, it was simply that they were stunned. Jesus is always more than they could absorb. And he has that very same effect on us today. He is more than we can absorb. And as we are studying this Gospel of John, it has just been more than I can absorb. So then we go into the full of grace and truth. Those two attributes that most closely connected with salvation is grace and truth, our grace and truth. Scripture teaches that salvation is wholly by believing God's truth in the gospel, by which one then receives his saving grace. There's no salvation grace except to those who believe in the truth of the gospel message. He, Jesus Christ, is the full expression of God's grace and truth, which was only partially revealed in the Old Testament. What was foreshadowed through prophecy, it became substance when it was realized in the person of Jesus Christ, Emmanuel, God with us, God in the flesh. In union with Christ, we experience his grace and his truth. And by his power, we can show that to others. So from his fullness, we have all received grace upon grace. What a precious verse that is. Full or fullness, it just indicates superabundance and completeness. So we have all received, and at this point now, John now includes all the believers. We have all received the abundant supply of God's grace. It will never be exhausted. It will never be diminished. Grace will continually flow. Grace in a limitless, never-ending flow. Grace upon grace. In one of the commentaries, it said that all believers receive Christ's fullness, but no single believer can receive all of Christ. It takes the whole body of Christ to appropriate his fullness and to express it. That statement, I thought it was a wonderful thought. We had to think on it for a moment, just stop for a second and think about this. It takes the whole body of Christ, which is the church, to appropriate his fullness and to express it. What does that mean? It means that each one of us, as we operate in the spiritual gifts that God has given us, as we work together in the body of Christ as the church, then we together become an example to the world of the fullness and the goodness of God. Amazing. It's wonderful. It's a great truth. And then I love this next section of verse 17 where it says, "For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ." I love this section because it made so much sense to me. And I pray that I'll be able to help you or convey the meaning to you as well. But the impact, again, of this truth is monumental. Grace triumphed over law. Since law was given by God through Moses, it was filled with God's glory, and it reflected his holy and righteous character. Yet, though God was gracious in the Old Testament, the law was not an instrument of grace. Rather, God granted grace and forgiveness to repentant sinners who violated his holy law based on Christ Jesus, based on what Christ would do to provide atonement. So Old Testament believers, they came to faith in the same manner that you and I do, in the sense that they are saved by grace through faith and faith alone, as they looked forward to the cross. They looked forward to the Messiah, Jesus Christ, and the cross. Now, as New Testament believers, we are saved by grace through faith as we look back to the Messiah and the cross. Wonderful. The law saves no one. It just merely convicts us of our inability to perfectly keep God's righteous standards. It reveals what our nature is and our need for the grace and forgiveness that he provides. Both law and grace express God's nature. They don't contradict each other. They express it. It's a fullness of God. Moses emphasized God's law and justice, while Jesus Christ comes to highlight God's mercy, his love, and forgiveness. You know what? God doesn't lower his standard. Instead, what he does is he transforms his people through grace. Now, the law that had been written on cold stone tablets is now written on our heart. It removes the heart of stone, and it writes the law on our flesh, the heart of flesh. It gives us a heart of flesh. It's a law that's written on our hearts. And because of God's great love for us and our love now for him, we seek to obey his commandments. Amazing and glorious. And then this last verse, 18, so jam-packed with truth. It says that no one has ever seen God, right? Except, right? The only God, Jesus Christ, who is at the Father's side. And through him, he has made God the Father known. Jesus, who existed in intimate fellowship with Father from all eternity, God the Father from all eternity, became flesh, and he brought with him that full expression of grace and truth to mankind, and he reveals God to us. The only Son, who is himself God, can communicate his glory to us. So the chief reason that people do not know God is not because God hides from them, it's because they hide from him. Oh, may they believe and receive Jesus Christ, the true light. So my friends, in closing, do you know the true light? You have been given truth today. It can no longer be denied. If you've not received Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, don't delay any longer. He is knocking at your door, the door of your heart. And won't you welcome him in? Welcome him in. And now, my dear sisters in Christ, let me remind you of grace upon grace. Nothing can complete Christ's fullness. His grace cannot be exhausted. Our times right now, they seem exhausting and overwhelming. We are trying to juggle so many things in the season of life that it overwhelms and exhausts us. You young mamas who are trying to juggle the hybrid schooling for multiple children, it's exhausting. For the rest who don't have that challenge, we have other challenges because we're listening to the rhetoric of the media and the noise of this world that is just clamoring and overwhelming. But God, grace upon grace. So take a moment and sit at his feet. Realign your vision and your priorities. It's by sitting at your feet, at his feet, that we realign our vision and our eyes, not to the things of this world and not to the pressures and stresses of this world, but to the one who has overcome all those things. So sit at his feet, be washed and immersed in his grace. It is at his feet that you will be refreshed and renewed. Exhaustion and overwhelming discouragement will fade away in the presence of the Almighty God. It fades away in the His presence. So may you walk this week in the super abundant grace that has no beginning and has no end. So let me close with this benediction, which is one of my favorites. It's out of Numbers 6. May the Lord bless and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. Let's close in prayer. Father, you are indeed the peacemaker. You are the one who bestows grace, and you are the light that is needed so badly in this world. And you have called us as daughters of the King to be the light to those who are still walking in darkness. So, Father, may we do that in the superabundance of your grace. May we do that in the power of your name, in the power of the Holy Spirit as he dwells within us. May we be the light and the life to the world that needs it so badly. But may we be the light and the life to our families, first and foremost. Father, to you be all the glory, the honor, and the praise, now and forevermore. Blessings to you all, and I will see you next.